Life's too short to eat amongst the crowd. It's more fun to be original. It's time for women to lead the gritty outdoor adventures when it comes to food and travel. For too long now, we've been relegated to cooking shows and looking pretty while the fellas stuff their faces with fatty food and whiskey. With Original Fare, we'll get out to the places that create real food with real folks.
They kind of walk real light because they feel the pressure and then they retreat.
My first victim is Hank Shaw. Hunter-gatherer extraordinaire, Hank reminds me of my country roots, but with all the survivalist knowledge to get us through the impending zombie apocalypse.
This is what you want.
That wasn't a great spooge. There you go. That's the money shot.
I got a handle on one. What you gotta do here is break the suction underneath him. Otherwise, he's just anchored with his foot underneath.
Nice.
That's a nice one.
See, that's his foot. That's what he anchors himself in the sand with. That's good meat right there. And then that's the siphon. And this is sort of what you see on the top. Mm-hmm. So this clam was down here, right? Mm-hmm. So that siphon came all the way to the surface.
Hank had a small entourage of serious Napa foragers, but this is not a man who needs to be taken so seriously.
It's just about as big as I've ever seen one.
No kidding.
It's the Ron Jeremy of clams.
Food can be so elitist. We slap local on the label and it becomes a high-end product. We make real food accessible to only the special few. It's people like Hank that have the ability to slash away at the facade we've so prettily packaged. He reminds us we just need to get out from behind the stove, the laptop, and the pulpit once in a while, reach our hands down deep into the mud, and get a little dirty.
You got your hand on it?
Hey, good for you.
I'm pissed. He really wasn't as big as I wanted him to be.
It's alright. You gave her.
Hank pushed us on as the tide crept back in. The cold, thick kelp kept sucking off my boots, but to me, this was a great day in paradise. Now, onto the wine.
I need to preface this by saying this is not a traditional chowder by any means. The chowder Nazis will be like, that's not chowder.
This guy pulls out his camp stove to cook a five-star meal.
The original chowders, if you look in the 1600s and 1700s in Massachusetts, all had white wine. If you put wine in a chowder in New England, it's not a chowder. This is clam juice. That's some clammy goodness. Sea beans. I mean, this thing has been around since the dinosaurs.
The trick is down here, if it's really old, you're gonna get kind of like a thread right in there. See that? This is dental floss. You gotta come all the way up where there's no dental floss.
You know that shitty, thick chowder that you can stand a spoon up in? The origin of that is from tourist places. A real chowder is difficult to make because you're putting milk into a reasonably hot, semi-acidic environment, so it can break real easy. So you have to be very gentle with it. You basically add the milk right before you serve. Well, if you've got a, you know, snot-nosed 15-year-old working a crab shack, right? They don't know how to do that. So they fixed it by making a roux. You know, any talking chimp can make a chowder with roux. And so then you got this weird tradition of it, oh, we should make it thicker. It's a pretty chowder, actually. You get a little bit of that orange from the salmon fat.
What would your mom say about this chowder?
Oh, it's nice, honey, but it's not chowder.